James Stevenson.
Howdy. How's it going?
Thanks for having us at Insomniac Games in California.
Thank you for flying all the way over.
Thanks.
Glad you can make it.
So, I'll just have a few questions to ask you. So.
Sure. I mean, I think, you know, I think that we already kind of have done that a little bit. We've shown, you know, with Deadlocked, you know, that we can do kind of a little bit darker, more co-op focused action game that was less platforming and that was kind of more of a shooter. And with All for One, we're doing very much a, you know, co-op game that is very kind of, you know, still has those action and platform elements, but is very different than anything we've done before. I always think Ratchet & Clank will have kind of the same DNA. People always want weapons and people always want those sort of elements, but we're always looking for ways to make it fresh and interesting to players. We talked about a lot of different things back before Deadlocked and Jackaxe obviously changed some of our plans. So like I said, I mean, I think some of those ideas became what All for One is. You know, we're always kind of thinking about what we want to do with our games in general and kind of want to do new things and show players new experiences and excite them in new ways. So, well, I think we'll always be trying to push the bar with everything we do. You know, I think we were trying to tell the story of his family, but tell it through Azimuth. Yeah. Like, I think it was just a different storytelling method. And sometimes when people think, you know, oh, you're going to talk all about the story of the Lombaxes, people were expecting to see them or maybe have us find them. But that wasn't kind of our goal with that. We knew we wanted to make time a big part of it. And so kind of when we were early on and we knew how good Clank's time gameplay felt and how time started taking over kind of the storyline, we then sort of adjusted the story to have it kind of make sense of Azimuth wanting to turn back time to undo what had happened. And so it all kind of came based off of the gameplay, really, and that being the main thrust. Some of the original ideas included, though, some of the things that were in the comic were actual story ideas that we had had for a crack in time that we didn't get to use, like stealing the planets. And so there's some other old story ideas that got scrapped. But, you know, it's always an evolution as we're sitting there kind of thinking about the ideas and seeing how the gameplay works and trying to tie those two as closely together as possible. And when the Clank time gameplay was really, really awesome, really early, was one of the first things we knew was going to be really good about A Crack in Time, we started kind of moving in that direction of focusing on time to kind of make the game stand apart. It's not as hard as you'd think. There's definitely a little bit of a gear shift, but you know, there's people that are here because they really want to work on Ratchet, and some of those people are in North Carolina, and there's people that are here because they really want to work on Resistance. So if you have to switch between the two, it's almost like a breath of fresh air in some ways, where you've been working on something dark and dreary, and then you get to work on something, you know, colorful and cartoony. But with our new production cycles, the teams are a little more stable over the period of time, so you get to stay kind of on a certain project. I do think people kind of like the shift, but then some people really like the shift. They get to do lots of different things. Other people are, you know, really about doing realistic things, and they really like doing the dark, gritty, real world, whereas other people want to do the very stylized Ratchet & Clank world. So it varies based on people, but it's all kind of like knowing what each individual person is excited about working on and what they want to do. I mean, there's always a chance. We would love for it to happen. You know, Hollywood is really a challenging place to do things and get everyone to work, because you've got, you know, we would want to be involved in some aspect to make sure, you know, it's up to the quality. Sony Computer Entertainment would want to be involved because they own Ratchet & Clank, and then you have to work with whoever's going to make it and what studio is going to do it. So there's a lot of moving pieces. I think obviously the world is ready for a Ratchet & Clank CG movie. It would be amazing if it happened. We want it to happen, but you know, just a lot of interesting Hollywood waters that you have to navigate to get something like that done. I think so. I mean, it's definitely a full Ratchet & Clank story. So it's a, you know, it may not be quite the, you know, Ratchet finding Alombax in his past and Clank having his higher destiny in front of him. So it may not be epic on that level of talking kind of about ultimate destinies for characters, but I do think it is a full Ratchet and Clank adventure with a story written by TJ, with cutscenes the way you've come to expect and know them, with tons of great writing, not just in those cutscenes, but now all the characters get to banter and talk during the levels themselves because all four characters are there. So there's a lot of great writing there as well. And you're going to explore this planet, Magnus. You're going to see a bunch of different environments, a bunch of different enemies. There's going to be some surprises along the way. It's a, you know, it is a Ratchet and Clank game. And it may not be kind of the epic future saga, but it is a full Ratchet and Clank story. And I think if you love Ratchet and Clank for the story and the characters, you're going to be very, very happy with All for One. I don't know. We've probably never thought about that. I mean, we've thought about those storylines. You know, I think people always want Ratchet and Clank. We went away from Clank for like one game and everyone was like, where's Clank? Where's Clank? Where's Clank? And people were kind of upset that they didn't get to see Clank or play as Clank. So it'd be tough to go away from both Ratchet and Clank at the same time. But no, it could be interesting. You know, anything is possible. Well, you know, it's hard when you're making video games because you have to make choices along the way. And so you kind of know how much resources, how much budget you're going to have to make a video game. And you have to decide how much of this is going to go into which pot. And I think Up Your Arsenal had a long campaign, but I think it was definitely shorter than Going Commando and the first game. And that was partially because, you know, some of the time and energy had to go into creating a multiplayer mode. And when you started getting to next gen, it was tough because, you know, we looked at, while we had multiplayer modes, and certainly the old PS2s didn't have online built in, you had to buy the network adapter. The people that played it loved it, and they played it all the time, but it wasn't a lot of people. So we had to decide, do we want to make an online mode for those people? And when most people really want the campaign and they really want the Ratchet campaign to be good. And so it was a really tough question, like, do we spend a good chunk of our resources? And if we had, say, had Online and Tools of Destruction or A Crack in Time, both of those games would have been significantly shorter campaigns. And we always hear, oh, we want a long campaign, we want tons of replayability, we want to play the game, then we want to go back and play it in replay mode, and we want that to last this long, we want all these new weapons. And online was just kind of a big hurdle. Plus, we were also working online on Resistance Fall of Man. So those are kind of the various factors that were at play. I think we've definitely recognized that people want to play online and they want to play with their friends, but bigger question is people always wanted to play co-op. And they kept saying, hey, let us play co-op. Let us play Ratchet and Clank together. And so we decided that, you know, that was what our focus was for All for One, was to let people play online co-op with each other. You know, who knows what'll happen in terms of those old competitive modes. I would hope, you know, and we've said this many times, that if Sony ever decides to do an HD collection of those games, it'd be really awesome to go back and play, like, Up Your Arsenal online in HD if that was part of the package. So I've got my fingers crossed that Sony might decide to do that someday and make that. But, you know, for the moment, we're just focusing on kind of co-op right now instead of competitive, even though we know people love that. I love that mode. I played a ton of that mode back in the day, and I didn't even work here at that point. It's always a hard decision to decide, you know, where your focus is going to be and how much of your resources you're going to devote to each thing. Anything's possible. I mean, you never know what could happen in the Ratchet and Clank universe. There's so many stories to tell. There's just a lot of opportunity for where the series could go. I don't know the exact details of kind of where that went. I definitely think there was kind of a desire to go in a new direction with the music from the creative side. And with the future saga, there was a little bit of a tonal shift to more kind of the cinematic Ratchet and Clank epic. Yeah. And I know we were looking for music to go along with that style, which is when Boris came in. And then, you know, when going to Michael Bross now, like, that, I think Boris was just super busy with Resistance and he had a lot of work on his plate, and you know, we had a relationship with Michael and knew that he could kind of hit the same interesting dynamics, and we love his Oddworld soundtracks. I think if you've heard some of the Ratchet music, it's really phenomenal and all for one. So we're just always trying to do the best music possible in for each game, and also to fit the game. And sometimes things change a little bit, but we're always, you know, from our audio department and our creative side, we're always looking to adjust. We're never going to keep doing the same thing just because that's what we did before. So, you know, I think folks will be very happy with Michael Brosh's soundtrack for All for One, though. We're really, really excited about it. I mean, I know they're doing their toy thing. I can't remember the name of it right now, but we see that. We don't really know much more beyond that. I think our old friend Mike Stout Dodger on the Insomniac forums is working on that game, and I've seen, you know, a couple videos and stuff, but that's really about it. We're bigger now than we were before, and we have the new studio in North Carolina that's working on All for One right now. The Resistance team is, you know, working on their game right now. Then the Overstrike team is working on their game. So, you know, we have enough people to do it. We've grown, and we've added a lot of great people over the years, and kind of grown to meet the demands of next-gen development, and to meet our own demand of giving ourselves more time to work on our games, because we're now spending 3 years on the games. So Resistance 3 and Ratchet & Clank All for One this fall both will be the first two games we've spent 3 years on, and I think you'll see a lot of polish and a lot of love, and the amount of time we had just to iterate. It's stunning how far All for One has come in some ways, because things like the weapon wheel weren't going to be in for a while, and we kept experimenting. We didn't know how we were going to do weapons. How do you do these things in a co-op game? And we just keep experimenting and experimenting, and we get to the point where we do have the weapon wheel, and we do have some of the weapon stuff, and you know, it took time to get to that point, and we're very grateful that we had the 3 years to spend on All for One, because I think it will show how good a game it is, thanks to the time that it got and the amount of energy that the North Carolina team has put into it. They're so passionate about it, and they're so excited about it, and it really is a work of love from them, and I think players will see that this fall. Ooh, that's a fun question. You know, there's been so much over the year. There's a lot of, I think people see a lot of 50s sci-fi influence. I mean, obviously, kind of everything that we grew up with in terms of films like Star Wars, and you know, going back to the Buck Rogers and that idea. If you go back to the very beginning of Ratchet and Clank, like, there's that definite strong 50s, 60s sci-fi movie, kind of the curved buildings and things like that. And you know, from there, you know, I feel like in some ways Ratchet and Clank has become its own style. It's very well defined. We very much know what a Ratchet and Clank item looks like. We have some amazing artists when you talk about Dave Gerton and Greg Baldwin, just to name a couple, but the two principal artists at Insomniac North Carolina now, but they were here before. You can see a lot of their work from Creature Box, and they did the covers for the Ratchet and Clank comics. So we have this style that is sort of uniquely theirs and our own now, and I think it kind of defines itself. But you know, there was obviously, I think if you go back to those very early Ratchet games, you can see sort of that 50s 60s sci-fi influence, especially. Both. I mean, obviously it's a bit different, so it's a departure in that aspect, but it's also an evolution. I mean, the weapons are there, the upgrades are there, the economy's there, the platforming is there, the world of Ratchet and Clank is there, the variety of the gameplay, the variety of the environments. So it is an evolution in many ways. It's a departure from a camera angle, and it's a departure from it being a single-player game. But I still think it's very Ratchet and Clank. And it very much fits with the rest of the Ratchet and Clank games, even though it's a little bit different. So both, I guess, in some ways. And it's a game we're really excited about. And, you know, I think it's tough because a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of very hardcore fans that are on your site, and they love what Ratchet and Clank is. They love block strafe, and they love, you know, kind of that jumping, shooting gameplay. And we all do. Like, I mean, we've all loved that game, and you know, it's done extremely well for us, but it is fun to do something a little bit different and also create a game where the whole family can kind of get in and four people can sit down and play and experience Ratchet and Clank together. And that's what I think is really, really exciting to us, is that it is a Ratchet and Clank game, but it's one that four people can sit on the couch and play together, or people on different parts of the planet can play together and enjoy together. Anything's possible. Who knows what we're going to do next? They're definitely an evolution. It's an evolution of the characters, but it's not like someone came in and changed them. This is Dave and Greg continuing to evolve the characters. And some of it's gameplay reasons, too. You know, when you're doing the four characters on the screen, you want them to, A, stand apart color-wise. So that's why Ratchet's kind of wearing the orange now and giving himself a very bright color that contrasts well with the green of Quark and the purple of blue of Nefarious, and then the cool blue-gray of Clank. And then Clank's size is obviously increased. He's a bit bigger, and that's just so he can stand out better on the screen, because if he was the normal small size you'd see him on Ratchet's back, he would not be as visible. But on the same token, when you play single player, you know, Clank's going to jump onto Ratchet's back or jump onto Quark's back or whoever you're playing as. So you'll see Clank, you know, still kind of jump back and shrink in. So there's a little like movie magic kind of. Clank's a little bit bigger when he's off the back. But at the same token, I think it's still very much the Ratchet and Clank style. And while we've tweaked things and we've stylized them a little bit more, it's a slightly different take, but it's still very much in kind of that big circle that is Ratchet and Clank. And it may not be quite the little more serious tone of the future epics, but you know, it's still definitely Ratchet and Clank. And like I said, if you want to ask going forward, who knows what's next? We're really focused on All for One. We want to make All for One the best game it can be and get it out. And what comes after that, we'll see. We played with it at E3. It looks really awesome. We're really excited about it. On that token, though, we're not really a handheld developer. We've always made kind of AAA home console games. That's our specialty. It's what we're really good at. So we're not planning anything for Vita right now. I don't know, you know, Sony decided to do Ratchet and Clank games on the PSP, which were done by High Impact Games, Size Matters and Secret Agent Clank. They also did a Resistance game on PSP called Retribution, that was Sony Bend, and they're doing a Resistance game on Vita, which is being done by Nihilistic. So I certainly think it's possible Sony could decide to do something. Obviously Ratchet and Clank is a huge franchise for them. And if they do, we would totally support that, but it would probably be something we wouldn't actually develop here at Insomniac.
I think that's it.
That's it?
Yeah.
Awesome. Can I say hello to everyone on Ratchet Galaxy, and thank you for watching, and glad you guys are checking all this stuff out.
So, thanks for following this interview, and we'll see you on the website sooner or later, and thank you.
Bye!